Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Leominster Baptist Church, our morning service. I'm Jeremy, the church secretary, and I'm just introducing this as Dean is away, our pastor is away finishing his thesis, his master's thesis. And we've invited a previous pastor, Derek Simpson, to preach to us today. So we look forward to what he's got to say to us shortly. A notice for members of the church that we will be holding our annual church meeting on Wednesday, the 28th of April at 7:30 here in the church, not here, this is our spare room. But we will be socially distanced in the church. We will need to be wearing masks, and if we need an overflow, we can use the hall at the back with a relay through to that. Perhaps I can read a psalm for us this morning, please. Psalm 95, verses 1 to 7. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship, let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. Let's pray together. We thank you, our God, that you indeed take care of us. Lord, we thank you that you sent your Son to redeem us, to give forgiveness for our sins through his blood shed on the cross. O Lord, we praise you for your mercy and your grace to us. We thank you so much for all the answers to prayer which you've given to us recently over the last weeks and months. Thank you for keeping us. Thank you for caring for us. Lord, we rejoice in your salvation and ask that you just keep us in your ways. Help us to keep to your paths. Thank you, Lord, for all your grace to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
I will sing. Good morning. It's good to be back. To those who know me, greetings and much love from North Lancashire. To those who don't know me, don't worry, you haven't missed much. Now, Jeremy tells me that Dean is doing a series on the book of Nehemiah, a most appropriate book for the present time. Now, in my experience of taking part in church leaders' conferences in many countries, I've discovered that this is one of the most preached on books of the Old Testament. The reasons are not hard to find. The number of key things that Nehemiah's life teaches us. Firstly, it teaches us about God's priorities. He tells us that God takes his holiness very seriously, and so should we. In the Old Testament, when God was introducing himself to his people or to an individual whom he wanted to use in his service, he frequently began with the words, "I, the Lord your God, am holy." That's important to God. Another of God's priorities is that he takes his commitment to his people very seriously. He enters into a solemn, binding covenant with them, a covenant built on relationship. In Exodus, he says this, "I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God." Another of God's priorities is keeping his word. God always keeps his promises. Now, not always as fast as we would like him to. Peter reminds us, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promises as some count slowness, as some understand slowness. So he teaches us about God's priorities. He also teaches us the role and importance of good leadership. It's a key theme of the book. The first exiles had been back in the land for decades and made little progress. They were a depressed and overwhelmed minority, no better off than they had been in captivity. All that changed when the right leaders, Ezra and Nehemiah, came along. However, leadership is not the theme of today's study. I will just say this. I believe that LBC has a good team of leaders who are men and women of faith and vision. They need and deserve your trust and support. Another of the key themes of the book is that every one of God's people has a place and a role to fill in the work of God. Again, it's an important theme of the book, but not of today's sermon. But I would like to tell you the story of a church. Now, this church is not in Herefordshire, I'll just tell you that. It's a church I knew well. Chris and I were members of it for a number of years, and the church got into difficulties. Someone in leadership did something very badly wrong. I'm not going to go into what it was. It had a huge impact on the church and threatened to pull the church apart. And if all this had become public, it had the potential to do great harm to the cause of the work of the gospel in that place. And as they were trying to find their way through it, something happened, which often does. We see it clearly in the life of Moses. When the people of God weren't happy, they turned on their leaders and on Moses, the main leader particularly, and it happened in that church. They turned on their leaders and the pastor, the lead pastor in particular, and made life almost impossible for him. As it happened, as they were trying to find a way through this, the pastor was preaching on Sunday evenings on the book of Nehemiah. And I was there one Sunday evening when he was preaching on chapter 3 and excellent teaching, as he always was from him. But as I sat there listening carefully, I felt that there was something really important in that chapter that God wanted to say to the church, and he hadn't said it. He hadn't drawn it out. And I understood why. Because as the senior leader of the church, it would be very difficult for him to talk about giving the senior leader of the church the respect and the support that he needed. So in the scene of the final hymn, I did something I've never done before. I'll probably never do it again. I went to him, I said, "Will you give me a few minutes to draw out one more thing from that chapter?" So at the end of the hymn, he sat everyone down and he said, "Derek wants to finish my sermon." Well, that's not how I would have put it. But then I said this to the church. "Look, we've been in real difficulty in this church and we're still struggling. I'm not a leader of the church and I'm not going to be a leader in this church. I'm a member of this church, as most people here tonight are. So I can say this perhaps when it would have been difficult for the pastor to say. Look, they were in an absolute mess with no hope out of getting out of it until they recognised that God had sent the leader to lead. And when the leader took the lead, and when he was able to appoint other leaders who took one section of wall, just a gateway or perhaps a 20-foot section of wall, and when most of the people didn't concern themselves with the master plan but just got on with moving stones on their 20-foot of wall, that's when they accomplished the miracle of rebuilding it all in 52 days. I said, "And what I hear in this church is everyone has an opinion on how the church should be led. Everyone wants to prevail against a group of people they disagree with, and it's destroying us. Let those of us who are members here, let the leaders lead and trust them. And let's let them give us our 20-foot of wall. And let's get down to the business of the hard work of moving stones and getting on with the job." You see, that's the lesson that comes out from the life of Nehemiah. If you want to see the church accomplish great things in Leinster, let the leaders lead, let them give you a job, and commit yourself heart and soul to doing it. I'm not a leader in Leinster Baptist Church. I can say it. Another key theme of the book is about the sovereignty of God in history. And we will never get anywhere in the work of God until we have a clear view of the sovereignty of God. You see, they had lived through decades of disaster and things weren't getting any better. Okay, they were back in the land, but they were a minority in it. They were dominated by foreigners and unbelievers, and they were getting nowhere. And maybe they thought that God couldn't do anything about it. But what we learn from the life of Nehemiah is this: what we learn about the sovereignty of God. However powerful the tide of history, God is stronger. However seemingly random and out of control the events of history, God overrules. However hopeless things may seem, God will fulfill all his purposes for his people. And however strong the opposition, no one and no thing can defeat God, nor his people when they walk with him. As we come out of this pandemic, as we wonder what the role of the church is now, let's remember the sovereignty of God and count on it. So when we consider the lessons from the book of Nehemiah, we see some points of similarity to our circumstances today. God's people had been through a bruising experience that caused many to doubt and give up hope. The way back seemed so difficult, many wondered if it was worth attempting. The way ahead seemed confusing and maybe very different to the past, which now looks temptingly secure. We can see those similarities. Of course, there are points of divergence. Let's not get things out of perspective. They had been away from their place of worship for decades, and it had been destroyed. We'd been out of our places of worship for a little over a year. Nearly all of them had no experience of their former place of worship, whereas nearly all of you can remember very well what it was like to go to church on Sunday morning. Only this Easter, on Good Friday and Easter Sunday morning, did Chris and I worship physically with believers again after more than a year. It was good to be back. It wasn't the same, but it was good to be back. And another point of divergence is that none of the former leaders were still there. They had to start from scratch. Whereas your leadership team has been with you and guiding you all the way through. They're still there. And for what it is worth, and looked at mostly from a distance, because I've been out of Leominster now for quite some time, it seems to me that they have done a very good job, and you have much cause to be grateful to them. So we need to have a sense of perspective. While this situation may have been the biggest challenge that Leominster Baptist Church has faced in many decades, it is actually quite small compared with many of the challenges that the Christian Church has faced in the past and is facing in different places today. Consider, for example, the plight of the persecuted church in many countries. So, we're actually thinking about, mostly this morning, about events that took place all within 1 year. It's the year 445 or 444 BC, depending on which commentator you read. And the events in chapter 2, verse 11 through to chapter 9 that I'm focusing on all take place within that 1 year. And I chose the reading to be from chapter 8 because it seems to me to be the chapter that really hits the nail on the head. And we see in those chapter 2, verse 11 to chapter 9, two important things: rebuilding the structures and rereading the scriptures. And those are the two things I want to concentrate on in the last few minutes: rebuilding the structures, rereading the scriptures. Now, I don't just mean the physical structures here, although the book of Nehemiah spends a lot of time on that. Your physical structures haven't been knocked down, they're still there. But no, they had to rebuild also the structure of daily life. Who would live where? The structure of society, the legal and the moral code. They had to rebuild the structure of worship and recommission, perhaps retrain, the priests and the Levites. Buildings are often the easy part. All the structures of life and worship, of fellowship and relationship, all of this they had to rebuild. And that's why chapter 8 puts the emphasis on the rereading of the scriptures. As they face those tasks, the important tasks, they wisely began by reading, explaining, and above all, following God's law. Let me read a few verses from Nehemiah 8 to you. Excuse me one moment. All the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, the women and the others who could understand. All the people listened attentively to the book of the law. You see, as they face the restructuring of their life and worship together, they realise that reading God's word, understanding it and building on it had to come first. And every structure that followed, legal code, the moral code, the social code, the worship, the ministries, their life and work together, all had to be built on the principles of God's word. And then we read on in Nehemiah that they took God's word out to every town and village and read, explained, and carefully followed it everywhere they went. Now this was important because this is where they'd gone wrong before. It's because they'd stopped doing this that they ended up turned out of the land and in exile for many decades. It's spoken of by Nehemiah as a period of 70 years, but in fact for some it was longer, for some it was a little shorter. They went wrong when they stopped really taking notice of God's law, God's word. You see, every generation needs to do this. Every generation of God's people need to come back to basics, back to the word, back to apply it to their life and times. This was something that they had got spectacularly wrong. And there are some things that the Christian church gets spectacularly wrong too. Some of you will know that in the 80s and 90s, I spent pretty much all my time as a travelling preacher, going around different parts of the UK, preaching in many, many situations, mostly outside churches, but also inside hundreds of churches of many different denominations. I got to know the church in our country very well. And as a young preacher, there's something that very quickly became very evident to me. There were many churches where they didn't care what was preached from the pulpit as long as it wasn't preached for more than 10 minutes. Any heresy could come out of that pulpit and nobody really minded. Just as long as you didn't move a pew or a kneeler or suggest updating the hymn book. You could change anything in God's word, deny it, contradict it, ignore it. Nobody batted an eyelid. But try to put a different person in charge of the flower rota and you were in big trouble. You see, they were concentrating on all the external things, but their hearts were no longer where God's heart was. And their lives no longer reflected the character of God. That's what happened in the days before Nehemiah. They still went on with the temple worship, but because their hearts weren't in it and because they didn't honour God and put him first, it became an abomination to him, not a pleasure to him. So much so that he said, I'd rather knock this temple down than have you people in it. There's an important lesson there. If you want to know what's gone wrong with the church in recent decades in our country, this is it. So much of the church, so many of the churches went far away from God's word. And we've seen them empty and close, as God would rather have them empty than have that kind of worship in it. There's an important lesson to learn. I could put it like this. We need to know what to carve and what to paint. What do I mean by that? We need to know what to carve and what to paint. Well, let me tell you about two churches that I knew personally. One was in East Lancashire. I think it may have been a Baptist church, but I'm not absolutely certain of that now. And I went there to preach one time, and as I walked in, I noticed that carved in big letters in stone was this: Sunday worship 11 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. I thought to myself, why did they carve that in stone? How did they know when they put this building up that would always be the best time to meet? And of course, they were still doing it at those times because, well, it was their tradition and it was carved in stone anyway. Surely that could have been painted or just printed and put on the notice board. As long as it says somewhere outside, we'd love to see you next Sunday at whatever time it is. That's all it needed. Didn't need to be carved in stone. Now, in another church, I think, well, I know this was an Anglican church. It's a church I was a member of for a time in Suffolk. Painted inside above the arch to the chancel was worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. I loved seeing that every time I went to worship. Now, they could have carved that in stone if they wanted. You see, in every place, in every generation, in whatever flavour of church it is, we are called to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. That should be carved in stone. That is something we should never, ever forget or stray away from. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. And the scriptures are very clear on the need to come together for worship, on what should be in our hearts when we worship, what the focus of our worship should be. All these things the New Testament is full of. Nowhere does it tell us what time to come together, how long to come together for, precisely what approach to take in our worship. As long as the essentials are there, you can do it any way at any time you please. Now, we worship on the first day of the week for good reasons, but it doesn't mean it can only be then. You see the difference I'm making here about what should be carved and what should be painted. There are some things we must never change. The way that we worship, what's in our hearts, the purpose of it, the word of God which we read and teach and follow. These things should be carved in stone. Everything else should be painted or printed and is subject to change. And perhaps God is giving us a great opportunity here to actually say, well, how should we as a church be doing things now? How should we meet the needs of different people? How do we make it possible for people to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness, to worship the Lord in faith and truth? What's the best way of doing that now? Maybe it's not the way we did it before. What's the best approach in the services? Maybe it's different to what we did before. How do we approach our various ministries to the community? How do we approach the sharing of the gospel with the town? Maybe it needs to be different ways. Oh, it's the same gospel. We're not changing that. But is it meeting the needs today? Is it getting to the people today? Is it speaking a language they understand? Is it meeting them in places that they congregate? When we want to draw them into the fellowship here, are we making it easy for them or difficult for them? Do our structures, physical and otherwise, assist them or are they a barrier to them? These are the questions. We need to discover God's vision for the church today and follow it. We need to constantly check the biblical principles and build on them. And we need to change any structure, physical or otherwise, that doesn't help fulfill the biblical mission today and the vision that God is giving the church today. And that actually is the history of Leominster Baptist Church. You see, tradition is very, very dangerous. When we do things simply because of tradition, we're in a very, very dangerous place. Never do something because the church has done it for a long time. Never do something because it's the Baptist way. Do it because it's founded on sound biblical principles and it's the best way of serving God today. Anything that doesn't do those two things, we should forget. And in fact, when you look back through the history of Leominster Baptist Church, that is the way it's been. In 1656, they saw the need for a Baptist place of worship, and they came together in a building by the bridge in Bridge Street. In 1771, they realised they needed to move to a new place and start again with a purpose-built building and the red brick buildings on the site today come from that time. In around 1895, the Victorians saw that there were needs that the buildings weren't meeting, so they changed the inside and built parts on the back, and it fitted the time. Further changes were made in the 1950s and the 1970s, and in 2007 we went back and again we changed the inside and added pieces on. And what we do with our physical structures, we should do with our other structures as well. Now, I understand from Jeremy that once again your buildings are under pressure and may not fit the needs of today. Then change them. Now, in 2007, we got planning permission not only for what we wanted to do, but we also built in planning permission for further work to go on afterwards. And if now's the time to do that work, you can do it and you don't have to go through all the long process that we went through before. Of course, it may well be that those plans are now the right ones for today. Will you so tear them up and draw the ones that are right? But whatever you do, don't do it because it's tradition, or don't do it because it's somebody's personal preference, just because somebody likes it or wants it a particular way. Do it because you've reread the scriptures and you know the principles and you've discovered the structures that are needed to fulfill the vision today, and go ahead with it. Now, I rejoice that the changes that were made in earlier times have paved the way for the church that exists today. And I'm very, very proud and glad to have been one of the many people involved in that. Let me close with a story. Some of you will know who I'm speaking about. It doesn't matter, because everything I'm going to say is to her credit. But in 2005, when we began talking about, or maybe 2004, the buildings that are in place today, we had the first meeting, and one lady, she gave her name, I'm not going to mention it, and she said, I can't remember if it was I'm 70 or I'm 75 years old, it was one of those two. She said, I love this church, and I love these buildings, and I love them just the way they are, and my heart sank. I thought, we're going to get the not over my dead body speech. And she went on, my parents were in this church, I was born here, dedicated here, in the Sunday school here, converted here, baptised here, married here, brought up my family here, and I'll probably be here to the end of my days, and I'll probably have my funeral service here. Well, as it happens, I did do her funeral service some years later. And then she said, but if changing it brings one more person to Jesus, let's change it. And I said, hallelujah. If you've got that view and you're septuagenarians, where can't you go? Where can't you go? So look at what you're doing and take her advice, firmly building on biblical principles. But if changing it brings one more person to Jesus, then change it. Let's see this as a time of wonderful opportunity to start again with God, with a new vision and new leaders and new structures, a new day to make sure that Leominster Baptist Church serves God exactly in the way that God wants to be served. And God bless you.